I mean, the liver is a hugely important organ. I think everybody appreciates that. It's involved in so many different elements of our normal physiology and maintaining our normal bodily functions. It's involved in digestion. It's involved in metabolism. I always tell patients when they come into the clinic, everything you put in your mouth goes through the liver in some form, whether it's medicines or herbals or food, whatever it is metabolized by the liver. And people forget that it's also an excretory organ too. The same way you get rid of toxins through your gut and through your urinary system, the bile is involved in getting rid of wastes that the liver has metabolized. So not being able to clear the bile, which is one of the problems in PBC, sometimes leads to accumulation of toxins, accumulation of bile, and that can lead to some of the symptoms. Why it happens is multifactorial. There's a lot of work going into understanding this. PBC is a remarkably interesting disease because it has a very specific antibody associated with it, this anti-mitochondrial antibody. There's no other disease in autoimmunity or in really any disease process that has such a specific autoantibody. And that tells us that there's probably some trigger for the immune system to develop this immune response to something. There's a lot of studies that have gone on to understand why an individual develops it and why another one doesn't. And it's most likely on the basis of some sort of genetic predisposition. I think that there has to be some sort of background genetic risk. But not everybody with that genetic risk will develop disease. It's a genetic risk with some sort of environmental exposure, be that an environmental antigen, an infection, whatever it might be, in the setting of a genetic risk that leads to disease. So I think about it like a sort of a Swiss cheese model. You have to have all those holes line up, and there has to be everything lined up to be able to have disease manifest. And it's only a small proportion of patients who ultimately end up with disease, whereas many more people probably have some or a few or maybe even just one of those underlying risks. There's a lot of genetic work, and a lot of it started out of our program that's trying to understand what puts people at risk for PBC. And there is, in my mind, almost certainly a genetic risk, but I think that that risk may not be specific to PBC. I think it's probably a risk associated with autoimmunity in general rather than liver disease in specific. And one of the reasons is that the same genetic markers that have been associated with disease risk in PBC have also been associated with disease risk in other autoimmune diseases like inflammatory bowel disease or like thyroid disease or like type 1 diabetes. So these immune conditions sort of run together, and there's lots of patients with PBC and other autoimmune conditions that have multiple autoimmune conditions, not just one, whether that be celiac disease or thyroid disease or Sjogren's disease or something like that. So I think the genetic risk is there. It's robust in the studies that have done sequencing of entire genomes to look for markers that are more prevalent in patients with disease compared to patients without disease. And certainly there are markers that come out as being significant in patients with PBC, but it's probably not just PBC. What usually happens in the diagnostic pathway is, I mean, people either have blood tests for a routine physical exam or they have symptoms of that are somewhat nonspecific, and they have a panel of blood tests, and their alkaline phosphatase or their liver tests are slightly elevated. And that will trigger the primary care doctor to send off a panel of blood tests to understand why those liver tests are elevated. Whenever I see people in the clinic, the fellows will have heard this 800 times in the last year, but I talk to people about why they have liver disease, how bad is it, and what we're gonna do about it. And in terms of why, there's millions of reasons your liver numbers can go up. They can be elevated because of fat in the liver, because of toxin ingestion, because of viruses, because of autoimmune conditions. And we can send a panel of blood tests to tease out those possibilities. And one of them in the right setting is an anti-mitochondrial antibody. And that's a pretty definitive test. It's either positive or negative. But some people have a negative AMA but still have PBC. And if the AMA is negative, that's not where the story ends. Sometimes we say you need a liver biopsy to decide whether PBC is there or not, but it requires a biopsy in that setting in most circumstances. A especially with autoimmune liver diseases, I tell patients that all of these tests are pieces of a puzzle. You have to let me put those pieces of the puzzle together and interpret the big picture. And no test on its own is enough. Not even an AMA on its own is enough, right? And a liver biopsy is a good test. We do it when we need that piece of information, and there is definitely a role for doing biopsies in the right setting, especially in autoimmune liver diseases. But it is sampling a centimeter or an inch of a big organ. And you're not definitely going to get the answer you want, but you hope that you're at least going to get clues to make that puzzle make sense. So it may not be perfect. It's usually pretty helpful, but it's not the only piece. Prognosis in PBC is really individual, but it's also dependent on how sick your liver is at the time of diagnosis, how long you've gone with undiagnosed disease, that's one, how much fibrosis or inflammation is there at the time of diagnosis, and whether or not you respond to therapy. Until recently, we just had ursodeoxycholic acid as the standard of therapy for PBC, and whether you respond to that therapy is a big indicator of prognosis. In people who respond to therapy, which is the vast majority of patients with PBC, their prognosis is excellent, and in most situations, equal to if you didn't have PBC at all, equal to an age and sex-matched cohort. I think there's two sort of buckets that I think of when it comes to symptoms. I think of symptoms associated with advanced liver disease, and in some of my talks previously and sometimes in the clinic, I talk about things like jaundice, yellow eyes, or ascites, fluid development in the belly or in the legs, or some people have had gastrointestinal bleeding. Those are symptoms of advanced liver disease. Some symptoms of PBC that are not necessarily reflective of stage of liver disease are things like itch, things like fatigue, things like dry eyes, dry mouth. Those are common symptoms, but don't necessarily correlate with how sick or not sick your liver is. But they are hugely important and a significant burden on quality of life metrics, right? Why they develop is, again, something if I knew the answer to, I would be out of a job. But I think it's hard. I mean, the fatigue is something that's nonspecific and happens for many, many reasons, but PBC is one of them. And why that happens to the degree it does in PBC is not yet clear. Physiologically, it's not yet clear. Sometimes it's associated with secondary causes like thyroid dysfunction, or like overweight, or being overweight, or like sleep apnea. There's other things that are contributing to it. Or mood instability and depression can aggravate fatigue and can be associated with PBC as well. Itch, I think, is a, we try to say that we understand it a little bit better. I'm not sure that we do, but it's probably related to circulating bile acids. When your bile ducts are inflamed and they're not able to clear, the bile acids accumulate, and that ends up in your bloodstream, and that can be a trigger for itch. So that, I think, we sort of have a bit more of a handle on. There's some research going into agents that can be helpful in itch. I usually start with the bile acid sequestrants like cholestyramine, and then some patients are eligible for an antibiotic called rifampin. Then there's antidepressants that sometimes we use that are not used in antidepressant doses, but in smaller doses, one specifically called sertraline. And then we can think about things like naltrexone, and sometimes we use gabapentin as well, which is a nerve modulator, and sometimes itch is helped by modulating nerve endings. So that's another good agent to use. But there are some drugs in development that target bile acid metabolism that are being studied for itch. For fatigue, there have been things that have been used to no avail in clinical studies. And for dry eyes and dry mouth, it's pretty much symptomatic. We look for underlying other autoimmune conditions like Sjogren's disease. And if those are diagnosed, then those are usually managed by a rheumatologist. And I get a lot of questions about diet and about the right diet. I think there's no evidence to say that certain diets help in PBC. What I do strongly believe is that any superimposed liver disease on top of PBC, if you have PBC, you have PBC. That's something that's there that we'll treat, but you have to monitor it. Another liver insult on top of that is going to be another challenge to your liver that it doesn't need, right? And the most common thing that we see in the liver clinic now is non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. And I think fat on top of PBC causes scarring and fibrosis and inflammation to progress faster. And so I don't think that there's a specific diet that anybody needs to engage in. I think maintaining a healthy body mass index and a healthy weight and a well-balanced diet with exercise is hugely important. I think that shouldn't be underestimated.
Hi, my name is Dr. Aliya Gulamhusein, and I'm a hepatologist at the Toronto Centre for Liver Disease. I'm a speaker and consultant with the PBC Society, and happy to be involved.